Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So you have today 12th of March 2021. All right, and these classes are basically meant for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examination, because you require to answer the few questions related to the current affairs. So for that, you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, which is available free of cost to you, where the day-to-day, the daily current affairs related news will be uploaded right through these lectures. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, and you can supplement our channel, you can supplement your preparation through these classes. Okay, and those students who are preparing for the civil services examination, this would be a great importance for them, because these classes are basically for the current affairs. Okay, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first is basically the news which is related to the Quad. What is Quad? Quad means the quadrilateral framework. So Quad is including of the four countries, that is United States of America, India, Australia and Japan. So these four countries are basically formed a Quad, which is known as a quadrilateral framework. This Quad is basically, you know, also considered as, you know, the NATO in India Pacific region or Indo-Pacific region, because the countries belongs to the Pacific Indian Ocean as well as the Indian Ocean belongs to this Quad. For example, Australia and the USA basically belongs to, you know, Australia, USA and Japan belongs to the Pacific Ocean. The Japan also, or Australia, basically belongs to the Pacific Ocean as well as Indian Ocean. So you can consider that these countries are basically having some sort of a resemblance with the Indo-Pacific, you know, grouping. So this type of grouping is basically, you know, are basically for coordination of the different things related to the different challenges which we are facing in the Indian Ocean as well as in the Pacific Ocean. As well as it is a vivid reply for the China's move, specifically in the Pacific Ocean as well as in the Indian Ocean. The China is a global threat for almost all countries. As you know, India is also facing a lot of challenges because of the China. The China's unilateral move, specifically in the Indian Ocean as well as in the Pacific Ocean, have threatened the global peace and the security. And to counter such move, a Quad was basically formed. Okay, now the Prime Minister Narendra Modi will attend the first Quad summit. This is the first Quad summit, which will be on the virtual platform, right? And that will be held on March 12, 2021. So here the Prime Minister Narendra Modi would join the US President, right, Joe Biden, the Australian PM Scott Morrison, the Japanese PM Yoshihide Suga, right, in the quadrilateral framework summit. So this is the first time the leaders of Indo-Pacific grouping are meeting. Okay, now the summit which will be held right on the March 12, 2021 is basically related to the different issues. Now the topic which is basically related to this Quad summit is the COVID-19 vaccines, because the vaccine is also, you know, the most important aspect of the coordination. Then cooperation on the technological front, then climatic change is also one of the important hot topic of the agenda in this summit, which will be held right among these four world leaders. Okay, now the Quad, which is basically consisting of US, Australia, India and Japan, right, is referred by the China as a Indo-Pacific NATO, right? And China considered this as a threat to the China's sovereignty, because the Quad is basically also focusing on restraining the Chinese move, specifically in the Indian Ocean as well as in the Pacific Ocean. So that is also the most important aspect of the formation of the Quad, right? And the China is also, you know, suspicious of the move of this Quad, right? And that will be challenged, you know, from the Beijing's recent move on the Pacific as well as in the line of actual control in the Ladakh. Okay, now, as you know that India is the world largest manufacturer of the vaccine, okay, and India is also world largest manufacturer of the generic medicines which will be manufactured in India. Okay, India has already shipped more than 48 million doses worldwide related to you know, the corona or vaccine, which is expected to request obviously the Quad investment or the countries or the investors from the Quad countries to scale up their outreach further related to, right, the India's move of providing, right, the millions of the doses worldwide related to the corona. Okay, next. So next news is basically the India-Japan space ties. Okay, so as the news suggests that this is the news related to the space or between two space agencies, between India and the Japan. So the Indian Space Agency, which is Indian Space and Research Organization, and Japanese Space Agency, which is the Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, which is also known as JAXA, both have signed a memorandum of understanding, okay, related to exploring the possibility of the coordination in the space sector. So India and Japanese space agencies, that is ISRO and the JAXA, have reviewed the cooperation in the Earth observation. Okay, so different aspect related to Earth observation, lunar cooperation, as well as the satellite navigation, right, would explore different opportunities that will be available between India and the Japan, and that will be basically for the cooperation specifically in the space technology, space field, right, in order to promote the awareness and the professional exchange program between the two countries. Okay, now this was basically agreed during a bilateral meeting that was held between ISRO and the JAXA, which was held virtually. Okay, now both agencies, that means ISRO and the JAXA, both have signed, right, an implementing agreement that will be full of collaborating activities related to the rice crop area and air quality monitoring using a satellite data. Okay, and both India and the Japan, that means ISRO and the JAXA, both are working basically for developing of joint lunar polar exploration mission, that is known as LUPEX mission. So that is the joint mission, both involving the ISRO and the JAXA, right? This is known as LUPEX mission. This LUPEX mission would be, you know, sending a lander, right? Just like, you know, the USA has sent just now Perseverance, a rover on the surface of the Mars. Both India and the Japan both is trying to send a lander and a rover on the surface of Moon, that is specifically on the southern pole of Moon. Okay, both are trying to send a lander and the rover, right, on the surface of the southern pole of the Moon around 2024. So this is also most important aspect between the India and the Japan, which is also related to the coordination and the cooperation among the agencies between the ISRO and the JAXA to for sending of this lander and the rover to the southern pole of Moon. Okay, under LUPEX mission. Fine. Next news is related to Swami Chidbhavananda. Swami Chidbhavananda is basically, you know, a founder of Sri Ramakrishna Tapovan Ashram. Sri Ramakrishna Tapovan Ashram was founded by Swami Chidbhavananda. Okay, he was basically belongs to Tamil Nadu. Okay, he was known for his literacy tradition, or he was known for his literary work, right? So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi have recently launched a Kindle version of the Swami Chidbhavananda's Bhagavad Gita. That means the translation of Bhagavad Gita into different languages was done by the followers as well as by Swami Chidbhavananda. Okay, now Prime Minister Narendra Modi have launched a Kindle version of this translation of Bhagavad Gita that was done by Swami Chidbhavananda. Okay, now so this Swami, which is basically born in 1898 and he died in 1985, he was a founder of Sri Ramakrishna Tapovanam Ashram, which is basically located at Tiruchirappalli district of Tamil Nadu. Okay, now the Swami Chidbhavananda basically have authored, right, more than 186 books. That means he has written more than 186 books, and he has contribution related to the literary composition in the various languages, right? And he is also the brilliant scholar. Scholarly work on the Gita, Bhagavad Gita, is one of the most extensive books on the subject. Okay, these books, or these pious books called Bhagavad Gita, have translated into different languages. For example, a Tamil version of Bhagavad Gita with its commentaries was published in 1951 originally. Okay, it was subsequently a translation, or the you know the translation was done into the English, and that was published right in English in 1965. And subsequently the translations were also done in the Telugu language, in the Odia language, in the German language, as well as in the Japanese language, right? But these translations were done by not by Swami Chidvananda, but by the devotees of the Swami Chidvananda. All right, so he is the person who is basically have the contribution related to the literary tradition. Okay, next, the Bamiyan Buddha. All you know that Bamiyan Buddha is very famous. It is a UNESCO's World Heritage Site. Okay, why the Bamiyan Buddha is in the news? Because in March 2001, the Taliban, which is basically currently stationed or the located in Afghanistan, have blown off this Bamiyan Buddha. So that means the Bamiyan Buddha currently is located in, it is a statue, it is the largest statue of Buddha, which is located in Afghanistan Bamiyan Valley. Okay, that is why it is known as Bamiyan Buddha, because it is the statue of Buddha which is located in Afghan's Bamiyan Valley. Just like our Kashmir Valley, there is a one valley in the Afghanistan that is known as Bamiyan Valley, and in that Bamiyan Valley a stone carved structure of the Buddha is there. Okay, now but the Taliban terrorists basically blown off, that means they put bombs in the largest statue of Buddhas, and they completely destroyed the monumental two monumental Buddha statue in the Afghanistan Bamiyan Valley in 2001. But still it is considered as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Now after 20 years of the destruction of the Bamiyan Buddhas, right, what happens is now this Buddha statue made a virtual return. That means now it has made a three-dimensional projection, okay, in place of that statue which was previously there as a live statue. So that means a night which is celebrated in the Bamiyan Valley, right, to celebrate the statue of the Bamiyan Buddha in terms of the 3D projection in an event called Night with Buddha. Okay, so now 2 decades later, an anniversary of the annihilation which is related to the Bamiyan Buddha have celebrated, and this is celebrated in the form of the 3D projection, just like you have the projectors now in your class. So there is 3D projection that was done on the plane surface. Okay, it looks like as if it is a statue, but it is just a three-dimensional projection which is filled with the memory of the Bamiyan Buddha. Okay, now let's understand the legacy of Bamiyan Buddha. The legacy of Bamiyan Buddha, first of all, you must understand it is a statue of Buddha, Lord Gautam Buddha. Now Gautam Buddha was basically born in India, okay, but his the traditions or his ideas basically reached out to almost every part of the world. Okay, now the Buddha which was two monument which was destroyed by the Taliban, right, to have different mudras. For example, these mudras were related to the draperies which were basically on the right shoulder of the Buddha. Okay, and it is a great example of the confluence of different artistic style. For example, it has the Gupta artistic style, it has the Sasanian artistic style, and it has also the Hellenistic artistic style. So it is a fusion of the three distinct styles, artistic styles, ultimately in the formation of Bamiyan Buddha. Okay, now it is said that this Bamiyan Buddhas to the date back to the 5th century AD. Okay, it was once the tallest statue of Buddha. It was the tallest statue of Buddha. Okay, now why it is considered as the tallest statue? Because its height was very high. For example, it rose to the height of 55 meters, and the second statue which was rising to 38 meters. You can consider 55 meters. Okay, both of these, the tallest statue was known at different names by the locals. For example, in the Afghanistan, they are known as Sal Sal. Okay, so it is a male statue which is known as Sal Sal. Okay, and the female statue or the female form is known as Shamama. Shamama and Sal Sal. What is Sal Sal? Sal Sal means the light which shines through the universe. Okay, and what is Shamama? Shamama means the queen mother. So these two statues have the local significance, which was 55 meters and 38 meters above, or that height. Okay, and it is known as the different names by the local people, right? Salsal and Shamama. Okay, now, as you know, they were basically the great height. Now, they were basically set an example of the Nike on, you know, on the sides of the cliff. That means they reaches to the extreme height of the cliff. Okay, now they can directly, you know, from the sandstone cliff, right? And following its destruction by the Taliban, right, the UNESCO still included the remains of this Bamiyan Buddha site as a World Heritage Site in 2003. Okay, still considered as a World Heritage Site with a subsequent effort which was made to restore and to reconstruct the Bamiyan Buddha, which was destroyed, right, by the Taliban in 2001. Okay, so you can see here the 3D projection which is related to the statue of Bamiyan Buddha. Okay, next, the menstruation taboo. What is menstruation? Menstruation, you know, it is basically, you know, a natural, you know, basically, you know, the cycle which is basically happens with the female. Okay, now a public interest litigation was filed with the Gujarat High Court, right, to basically end some sort of a discriminatory practices related to the menstrual cycle. Okay, so in the response to this public interest litigation, the Gujarat High Court passed an order, okay, proposing the 9 guidelines that the state of Gujarat should follow to end the menstruation cycle and the you know, the stigma related to the menstruation taboo and the discriminatory practices which is pertaining to such menstruating women. Okay, now this guidelines calls for the prohibiting social exclusion of women. Okay, now because of this menstruating cycle and because of menstruating women, now certain prohibition was basically practiced against such women on the basis of their menstrual status at all the places. For example, in different places, for example, the religious places also, the menstrual woman is not allowed to worship. Okay, we'll see in the Sabarimala temple also it was the practice, be it a private place or in the public place or the religious place or in the education place. Okay, now the Gujarat High Court basically passed an order and it stated that it is the responsibility of the state government, okay, to raise the awareness related to the menstruation, right, including it should be included in the school curriculum because it is the most important and the sensational, you know, issue in the society. So it should be included in the school curriculum and the people should be sensitized, right, with such, you know, the menstrual taboo which is being considered as, you know, a taboo in Indian society, and based on that certain discrimination is basically, you know, held against the women, those women who are basically in their menstrual cycle. Okay, now if you see the previous judgment which was passed by the Honorable Supreme Court of India, okay, specifically in the Sabarimala temple entry judgment. Okay, have you seen the Sabarimala? Have you seen the Sabarimala temple? It is a famous temple. Okay, in the Sabarimala temple also the woman or menstrual woman is not allowed to perform the worship. So the judgment was delivered in 2019, okay, regarding the menstruation as a polluting or impure. So in the Sabarimala deities or the people who are working in the Sabarimala, they considered that the menstruation is basically a polluting or impure, okay, and it is associated with certain set of disabilities on the basis of the menstrual status. Okay, and such disabilities according to the Honorable Supreme Court of India is against the dignity of a woman, right, as this dignity of the woman is guaranteed by the Constitution, right, under the fundamental rights. The second judgment was delivered by the Delhi High Court in November 2020. Now the Delhi High Court asked the government authorities, right, when the PIL was filed, right, to grant a paid leave, because what happens is if the woman is in her menstrual, you know, the day, what will happen during that period, the woman is unable to work, right? So what happens is the all the women employees according to the Delhi High Court, employer should be providing, right, a paid, you know, a grant, right, so that the woman should not be affected. So according to Delhi High Court, right, Delhi High Court gave the direction to grant a paid period. That means if the woman take the holiday, you should pay for it. It should be paid, right, to leave the woman, all women employees, for 4 days each month. Okay, and payment of overtime allowance. That means if the woman, or if such menstrual woman is working in the office, and if the day is the day of period, right, the overtime allowances should be given to the woman, right, who opt to work during the menstruation period. So such guidelines were there, which was issued by Honorable Supreme Court as well as the Delhi High Court also in previously. Okay, next, the genome mapping in Indian Ocean. Okay, so here, in just like, you know, the genome mapping which is done on the human body, the genome mapping will also be done in the Indian Ocean. That means the scientists from the National Institute of Oceanography, which is a premier institute in Panaji in Goa, okay, the scientists from the National Institute of Oceanography, right, would basically, you know, take their vessel or research vessel known as Sindhu Sadhana to the Indian Ocean, okay, to the next 3 months. So in the vessel called Sindhu Sadhana, the scientists will perform, or scientists will perform different, you know, experiments. They will take out, right, the samples of, you know, the organism, the samples of, you know, the basically the water at different depths of the Indian Ocean. Okay, and they will be traversing the course over 10,000 nautical miles in the Indian Ocean region. So it is a research project for the National Institute of Oceanography to reveal the internal working of the body of the ocean at the cellular level, right, in order to map the genome in the Indian Ocean region. So it is a first of its kind project, which is aimed at the understanding the biochemistry and the response of the ocean to related to the climatic change, to the nutrient stress, and to the increasing pollution. So it is the research project to understand, right, the response of the ocean, which is impacting due to the climatic changes, the climatic variations, increasing the temperature, increasing the salinity, increasing in changes in the density, as well as certain set of nutrient stresses and different type of pollution, right, which is happening in the oceanic region. Okay, what would be the response, right, that will be studied by this project. Now this research project will take 3 years to complete. Sorry, 3 years to complete. Now the researchers from the National Institute of Oceanography would travel to the Indian Ocean in this vessel called, you know, the Sindhu Sadhana, right, specifically from India's east coast. Now they will be moving to the Australia, then they will move to the Port Louis in the Mauritius, then they would move up to the border of Pakistan of the India's west coast, right, and they will gather the samples of the genome mapping of microorganism. That means they will take the samples of the microorganism at that height of, or at the depth of around 5 kilometers inside the Indian Ocean. So what would they do? They would collect the samples of the microorganism. They would try to find out the response of the oceans in the case of the pollution, in the case of the increasing of the temperature, salinity, and increasing of various aspects of the oceans. Okay, so the researchers will collect the samples from the various stretches of the ocean at an average depth of 5 kilometers. That means they will collect the sample, right, from the depth of the 5 kilometers. Fine. Now, just like a gene mapping which is done by the scientists, what they do, they will collect the blood samples, okay, from the humans, right. The scientists here will collect the samples of the microorganism means they will collect the samples of bacteria, they will collect the samples of microbes which are found at least 5 kilometers deeper inside the Indian Ocean, and they will try to see mapping those sequence or genome sequences, what would be the reaction or what would be the changes in the oceans with respect to any imbalances. Okay, so this would help the Indian scientists to understand the internal working of the ecosystem of the Indian Ocean. Okay, now at various stages and stretches, the samples will be collected by lowering a Kevlar cable, a cable that will be lowered up to 8 kilometers of the depth inside the Indian Ocean region. Okay, and that will include a set of 24 Teflon coated bottles. Okay, these coated bottles will be lowered also to the depth of 8 kilometers, and they will collect the samples of the microbes specifically from that depth. So you can see, this is basically, you know, the scientists will move from the eastern coast of India, from the Vizag. They will move in this path. Okay, they would reach to this path, they would come back, and they would cover this portion of Indian Ocean, and they will return back to the western coast of, you know, the Indian Ocean region. Okay, so this is the cruise track that will be followed by the scientist of the National Institute of Oceanography. Okay, next, the trusted telecom rules. What is trusted telecom rules? So here, the Department of Telecommunication has amended the licensing conditions for the telecom companies. For example, if they want to take the license, right, for you know, sending different, you know, the telecommunication channel, you know the waves, or for telecommunications, they will have to comply with those directions, right? So what are these are included by the Department of Telecommunication? They include the defense and the national security as a parameter when purchasing the trusted telecom products and the sourcing equipment from the trusted telecom equipment sources. That means the Department of Telecommunication has bounded the telecommunication companies or telecom companies to purchase only the products, right, as well as the equipments only from those sources which are trusted or which are included in the trusted telecom equipment sources. If they are not purchasing, right, those sources, they will not be eligible to get the license. That means the Department of Telecommunication has included the aspect of defense and the national security. Why it has included the defense and the national security as a status? Because the Chinese firms, specifically those supplying those instruments, right, those equipments are basically, you know, they fitted with certain software, and these software are basically in the form of virus or in the form of a malware, which will be, you know, the Indian networks, Indian systems are basically vulnerable to the Chinese threat. The China is basically snooping on the Indian companies, on the Indian government websites through this supplying of these equipments. So in order to contain such issues, the trusted telecom equipment sources is must for the telecom companies to purchase, right, those equipments and the products. So here, including the defense and the national security as a parameter, which means a design authority can take only those products which are deemed safe. That means they cannot use those projects which are deemed unsafe and these are not sourced from the trusted partner. So that means the new norms will kick from the June 15th of this year. Okay, in that, after kicking off these norms, the telecom companies will not be able to use any product, right, where these products appear to be, right, sourced from the not trusted, you know, the, you know, telecom partner. So that means they should be using all equipments and all products from the trusted partner only. If the telecom company wishes to expand their network by using any equipment, okay, that does not come from the trusted source. Now, what will happen if they have to use such source? They will have to take the prior permission from the designed authority. Who is the designed authority? The National Cyber Security Coordinator. Okay, so they have to take the permission from the National Cyber Security Coordinator if the telecom company wishes to use such equipment or the products which are not sourced from the trusted source. All right, so they would have to take the permission from the National Cyber Security Coordinator. Fine. Next, the inner line permit system. So this inner line permit system is applicable in the different states. What is inner line permit system? In the inner line permit system, right, there should be, or the person who is visiting, right, inside this inner line, so there is a line which is basically mandated by the government. no one is allowed to enter inside that line. That means the government require that you have to take a permission if you want to go or if you want to cross beyond a line. That is called inner line, right? Anyone is not allowed to enter just freely inside this inner line permit. Okay, so you need a permit or you need a pass when you want to enter into some inner line. Okay, so this inner line permit system is applicable in the Uttarakhand also. So Uttarakhand government recently asked the Union Home Minister, okay, Amit Shah, to withdraw this inner line permit system, which is basically there in the Niti Valley of Chamoli district and the Nilang Valley of Uttarakhasi district of Uttarakhand. Okay, why the Uttarakhand government sought the withdrawal of inner line permit from the Niti Valley and the Nilang Valley of Uttarakhand? It has asked because, right, this inner line permit has restricted the border management or better border management, and it has also restrained the expansion of the tourism in the villages which are located inside the inner line, you know, system. So because of that, the Uttarakhand government has sought to remove this inner line permit from the Niti Valley and the Nilang Valley of Uttarakhand. Okay, now this inner line permit system restrains the movement in the area which is closer to the border. That means Uttarakhand, basically, you know, Uttarakhand is a state basically of India. Okay, Uttarakhand touches two countries, that is Nepal and China. Okay, both Nepal and China touches Uttarakhand. Now what India has done, India has made an inner line permit system that no one is allowed to move so close to the international border, that is the China's border or the Nepal border, from the India side. So for that, the inner line permit have been made from the Indian side. Okay, now for that, if you want to cross that inner line, you have to take the permission from the government of Uttarakhand. Now in the Uttarakhand, the tourists have to obtain the inner line permit. That means agar aap tourist ho and if you are going there over there, you have to take a permission from the government if you want to go near to the China's border, specifically in the three districts, Uttarakhasi district of Uttarakhand, Pitoragarh district of Uttarakhand and Chamoli district of Uttarakhand. Okay, so first is Pitoragarh district of Uttarakhand. See, Pitoragarh district is strategically more sensitive. Why it is strategically more sensitive? Because Pitoragarh touches with the China and Nepal. So Pitoragarh aapki China aur Nepal ko touch karti hai. Theek hai? Same thing, the Nilong Valley in the Uttarakhasi district of Uttarakhand, the Nilong Valley also touches the China. So here also, the Nilong Valley also required the inner line area or inner line permit because it touches the China. Okay, and it is approximately 100 kilometers from the Uttarakhasi headquarters. Fine. Then the third is basically the Niti village, which is located in the Chamoli district of Uttarakhand. It is basically located at the altitude of 3600 kilometers. Okay, now it is the village which is known as Niti village. The Niti village is the last village of India, which is located in the Chamoli district, which is the last populated village before the Chinese border. So you can see in this figure, the Niti village is the last populated village in India's, within the India side, in the India and China border. Okay, next, Tirath Singh Rawat. You have seen that in Uttarakhand, the previous, you know, the chief minister of Uttarakhand have been stepped down recently, and the new chief minister Tirath Singh Rawat have been sworn as the new chief minister of Uttarakhand. Okay, now the Tirath Singh Rawat is basically a member of parliament from the Pauri. Now he is 56 years old and he is replacing the Trivendra Singh Rawat, who was the previous chief minister of Uttarakhand, right? Now some of the key constitutional provisions related to the chief minister. So article 163 clause 1 of the Indian constitution provide that there shall be a council of minister with chief minister as a head. That means there shall be a council of minister. This council of minister consisting of the cabinet minister, the minister of state independent charge, the minister of state and the deputy ministers, right? And these council of ministers should be headed by the chief minister, which will aid and advise to the governor. That means always there shall be a council of minister who will aid and advise to the governor in exercise of their functions. Okay, and except the governor, which is required to work according to his discretion. Otherwise, the governor has to be compulsory taken the aid and advice from the Council of Ministers, which is been headed by your chief minister. That is Article 163. What is Article 164? Article 164 clause 1 says that the chief minister shall be appointed by the governor, okay, and other ministers are also appointed by the governor, but that too on the advice of the chief minister. Okay, then Article 164.2, Article 164.2 says that the Council of Ministers shall be collectively responsible to the Legislative Assembly of the state, right? So that means they will act as a team, they will act as a team, and they will basically swim as a team, they will sink and the swim together. So they are collectively responsible to the lower house, okay, of the state. That is called Legislative Assembly, or that is also called the Vidhan Sabha. So they are collectively responsible to the Vidhan Sabha, that is the lower house of the state legislature, or Vidhan Parishad, which is known as the Legislative Council. Alright, so these three articles in the constitution is the most important articles related to the chief minister and related to the relationship between the Council of Ministers and your governor. So he is basically the new chief minister, who is Tirath Singh Rawat. Next, the Shramik Kalyan Portal. What is Shramik Kalyan Portal? See, the Shramik Kalyan Portal is basically a portal for the payment of the wages to the contractual workers. Okay, so contractual workers, those workers who are not working as a full-time employment, who do not comes under full-time employment category, they are called contractual workers. That means they are employed only for, say, for the few months or for years, say for 6 months, 1 year or two years. Okay, now the Indian Railway is recently said that it will ensure 100% compliance of the payment of the minimum wage. So that wage will be provided to the contractual workers through the e-application Shramik Kalyan Portal. So this portal is basically a medium to give the payment to those contractual workers a minimum wage. So the Indian Railway Shramik Kalyan e-application have been developed, and it has been launched in the 1st October 2018. Okay. Now, this e-application of the Shramik, or the Shramik Kalyan Portal, ensures the compliance of the provisions of the Minimum Wage Act, which ensure also that the minimum wages will be provided to the contractual workers through this Shramik Kalyan Portal. Okay. And Indian Railways will get their rightful due by enforcing the contractors to regularly upload wage payment data into this application, or into this e-application of Shramik Kalyan Portal. Okay, now this e-application of the Shramik Kalyan Portal, or paying of this the minimum wage to the contractual workers, will also help the railways, right, as a principal employer, because a railway is the largest employer in our country, largest public sector employer, okay, which also keeps vigil over the wages which are disbursed by the contractors to the contractual workers. Sometimes what happens is the contractors do not disburse these wages to the contractual workers on time. So obviously with this Shramik Kalyan Portal, the Railway Ministry will keep an eye on the contractors, whether they are getting, or whether the contractual workers are getting the rightful wages or minimum wages as per the Minimum Wage Act. All PSUs or public sector undertakings work under the Ministry of Railways are using this e-application of Shramik Kalyan Portal. Alright, so that's all for today. Thank you very much. We will meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you.